The last talk, and in fact, what the work shows is that messing up with components actually may screw up the emerging property, the collective behavior, which is something in which this is part of the evaluation of our environmental policy. So, our last talk is from Paolo Dodorico, professor in the University of Virginia, from grew up in Padua, very dear to us. No, no break now. We just had it. No, that's what I thought. And then we have a break at the end. The coffee's there, so we presume that we have blocks of two talks.
Okay, good.
You have it there. And well, Paolo is a hydrologist with many interests in a variety of issues from ecology. He trained himself to become a field ecologist in Africa, actually. And he became interested in food security. For a part which is somewhat water controlled, so something which you do have some experience, and I presume we'll be talking about the virtual water trade networks. Is that what you'll be talking about?
Yeah, more or less.
More or less, because it's total freedom is given to the speakers. And quite a few issues that are bound to become mainstream in hydrology. We keep telling all the students in environmental sciences hydrology that issues like land grabbing that he does with Christina Rulli, that the virtual water trade networks and the related food security, the global, it's a globalized world, more stable or more unstable, perhaps. So these are important questions that need to be solved. So, Paolo, you can use the
okay, good.
But you're too tall, actually. Yeah,
yeah, I move it here. It seems to be a little bit odd. Okay, thanks for the invitation, and thanks for sticking here until the end. So the goal of this talk is to look at water as one of the factors contributing to the production of food and as a fundamental resource that on which human societies depend on. So I will look in particular at mechanisms of redistribution of water resources associated with trade or with acquisition of land I call them long distance land acquisitions. And so we will see what are some of the common problems of these mechanisms of redistribution of water resources. And so first of all, water is a fundamental resource for the production of food. Most of the water we use is used in agriculture. And most of the water we use is used for the production of food. Only a very tiny portion of the water we use is for drinking. So most of the times we need to stress the fact that the water crisis is a crisis of a hungry world and not of a crisis of a thirsty world, as many people would think. And the important question is whether we are about to run out of water for food production. There has been some quantitative studies trying to show that we are heavily using the global freshwater resources. The study by Volkermark and Rockström stressed that at the time when they did the study, there were 6.5 billion of people, 800 million people more or less malnourished, and total consumption of fresh water for food production was 4,500 cubic kilometers per year. And now, and they did the calculations that by the year 2050, there would have been, we know, three more billion people. And if we have the goal of eradicating malnourishment and bringing everybody to a balanced diet, we need to increase the pressure on the global freshwater resources by almost 100%. So we need another 4,200 cubic kilometers per year, and which can be found only partly in irrigation water, because most of the rivers of the world are already heavily used. Some rivers, and we know the story of the Colorado River, the Rio Grande, don't even reach the ocean anymore, and because of heavy withdrawals for agriculture. Then these authors suggested that with a better soil water management, we can really achieve save some water if we maintain transpiration, but we reduce evaporation, for example, with drip irrigation or other techniques, we can maximize or improve the use of water. And the other approach that we are suggesting is that we can rely on new technology, again, the so-called more crop per drop, so techniques that use less water to produce more food. And clearly, in addition, this type of analysis didn't account for other factors, so didn't account at the time for the fact that there is an increasing use of food that, like meat, that is more water intensive. We need 4 to 10 more, 10 times more water to produce 1 calorie of meat than a calorie of plant food. And there is this trajectory that along a pathway of development, societies, as they become more affluent, they consume more meat. In addition to this, this analysis didn't account for the effect of biofuels, which a new energy policies, and we read that in the news, have increased, again, the pressure on the agricultural system, and indirectly also a pressure on the global freshwater resources. So again, the question whether we are running out of water, we know that these are not new ideas. The fact that even Malthus suggested that the global population is growing faster than the resources that than the rate at which resources are available to the global population. I need to say that, like Marino, I wanted to try to find an outfit or a collar like that, but I didn't find anything, so you need to accept a normal tie. The idea of Malthus has been challenged from different angles, so the angle of the fact that it's not a food security, not a problem of availability, it's a problem of access. The two problems are often coupled. It's been challenged also because Malthus didn't account for the fact that the new technological innovations would have changed our ability to produce food. If we look at the recent history, the modern history of humanity, we have we had the Industrial Revolution that clearly contributed to produce more food thanks to new machineries, and also the Green Revolution in the decades after World War II, with the availability of nitrogen fertilizers and irrigation and mechanized agriculture, and also genetically modified crops, new cultivars, etc. Now, in more recent times, there have been other revolutions, that, and I say revolution because these innovations tend to appear like in not continuously, but in a big change. And another big change we had in the last 30 years has been this increase in global trade that has allowed to redistribute around the world the food and the indirectly also the resources that are required to produce this food. Finally, there has been now, when we look at new strategies to improve food security, the new one of the strategies, there was an issue in the National Geographic magazine last month. The most scientists agree that an increase in crop yields and the closure of the yield gap is the way in which we can improve or enhance food security while without compromising too many natural resources. And the closure of the yield gaps requires bringing existing technologies into parts of the developing world that have not been reached by these technologies. And one of the mechanisms through which this might happen is through large-scale investments in agriculture, many times also not by local communities, by external investors, for example, foreign investors. And so in this talk, I will focus on these two mechanisms, and we will look at how these two mechanisms have some common issues that we will discuss from an environmental, ethical point of view. Issues related, again, to the redistribution of resources. If we look at a comparison between demand and supply, we find that there are of water for food production, we see that there are regions of the world that are in abundance, regions that are in deficit. And this is possible. And to deal with this situation, people might decide if the supply is less than the demand, either to relocate themselves. But if we look at the global patterns of international migration, only 3% of the world population is an international migrant. Other than that, so the real mechanism through this, which this happens is mainly trade. And more recently, instead of trading people, we might have this trading of land. So if climate controls the availability, population size, type of diet control the water demand. And if the demand is bigger than the supply, we might have a situation in which a population accepts a consumption rate less than the demand, maybe by reducing waste or accepting a certain level of undernourishment, or it might import food from somewhere else, which means that somewhere else around the world there is an excess in the supply with respect to the demand, and this gives room for a market of trade of food. And associated with the market of the trade of food, there is also a trade of the water required for the production of food, which is called virtual water. And the notion of virtual water was proposed by Allan in the late 90s, is that every commodity has its own water cost, and so we can think that embedded in this commodity virtually is present a certain amount of water. By trading this commodity, we trade the virtual water. We have reconstructed, and other groups have also done the same, the global network of virtual water trade, identifying and this is an interesting example of a social network, in the identifying links through which water is redistributed around the world. An interesting factor is that if we look in the last few years, and we look at the net exporters, that would be for 2009, we see that more than 50% of the water placed in the global market is contributed by four countries, which means that there is a small portion of the world population that controls most of the resources that are traded. There has been over time an intensification in trade, so there has been the number of links in the network has increased, the total volume of products and also virtual water that is traded has increased, has almost more than doubled in 25 years. In terms of countries with different types of numbers of connections, we see that also these connections have increased, and the interesting part is that Southeast Asia has become much more integrated in the global market of virtual water trade. Africa is still only partly involved. In a similar way, this is a work done with Christina Rulli and her students. We have reconstructed the global network of trade of water for biofuel production. And we see that there is a heavy demand of the western part of the world on imports from, in particular for biodiesel, from Southeast Asia. So the question is whether we know that there are some virtues with virtual water trade, the fact that we can, for example, in case of a crisis of a drought in a part of the world, the main problem in that case there would be a crop failure, and we can, by moving food from a part of the world to another, we can help a certain population. So there are some benefits to this. For another example, the Middle East is in a chronic water scarcity, and instead of having water wars, we can just through trade find a way for populations to meet their demands. But there are also we need to remember that there are some negative aspects to virtual water trade. One of them is the fact that it establishes a disconnection between consumers and production regions. This means that people are consumers' choices are less driven by an attention to the natural environment. It's what we could define as a loss of environmental or ecosystem stewardship. There is also a We need to check if there is an impact on trade, on inequality in the access to water. Does it does trade increase or decrease this inequality? And then we will see that it's not a long-term solution to the water crisis. We have seen also that there are other issues associated with the fact that there is a trade dependency in some countries, or the fact that there is a loss of societal resilience because the world is much more connected and the world has less redundancy, in a way that if there is a crisis, there isn't much of unallocated resource that can be used to face that crisis. And I will talk only about the first three points, and we will look first at the loss of environmental stewardship. So if a country imports a commodity, it virtually imports the water that is required to produce the commodity in the form of green water, which is rainwater, or blue water, which is irrigation water. Which means that at the same time, since the production of agricultural of a crop has an environmental cost, for example, pollution caused by fertilizers and pesticides, it's as if the importer was exporting to the exporting country these environmental damages. So, as a result, the exporting country will have to allocate, for example, if pollution is a famous solution to, or dilution is a famous solution to pollution, will have to allocate some water to dilute these pollutants. This water is usually called grey water and is imported along that product. So we can look at the global network of grey water trade as a network through which environmental impacts are transferred from a country to another. And we see that in red are the countries that bear the environmental cost of food production. And if we look at them, and this pie chart would show that, again, like a handful of countries bear more of the 50% of the grey water burden of food trade. There is an interesting literature on the so-called ecological unequal exchange. The typical narrative is that core countries tend to export to the emerging countries, the developing countries, more of the environmental impacts of their consumption habits. This is an exception. In this case, if we look here, this exportation of environmental damage from agricultural production goes more into the more developed countries. So the implications, from the point of view, I think, of environmental economists, the big problem here is that most of the times the environmental costs are not accounted for in the cost of a commodity, and so there is an externality that needs to be accounted for. And then, now I connect a little bit to what Marina was saying before. This is for sure one step, but it's not the whole way to fix the problem, because clearly the problem of the environmental impacts remain, particularly if this is a severe environmental damage or degradation. There is no, by incorporating this price, yes, we fix a little bit the problem, but there is still the reality that it's not by introducing notions like ecosystem services and that we can think of treating nature as a commodity and put a price tag on nature. And so the next step would be really to find at least be aware of the fact that there is an environmental impact in some cases can be substantial. And again, it's not by trading money for natural capital or substituting one with another that the complete solution to the problem can be found. Then, from the point of view of equality, we can use the formalism again of the Gini coefficient if we plot the distribution of population that is on one axis and on the other axis the resources this population has access to. If the empirical data fell on a one-to-one line, we would have that 20% of people have access to 20% of the resource. This is usually not the case, And the typical curve is something similar to what we find at the blue curve. The area is called the Gini coefficient, is a measure of inequality. If we do this for water use, we see that there is a Gini coefficient of 0.22, and in a distribution of global freshwater resources, it's a higher number. And if we look at the contribution, yeah. So in one case we look at in one case we have population for each country, we have a population, and we have the amount of water that population uses. In the second case we have the population of a country and the water endowment of that country. And then we can split and see which sector contributes more to the inequality, and we find that agriculture is the main factor, and we know a big surprise. But still, trade has an impact, and we can see if trade changes the distribution, contributes to an increase or decrease of inequality. Now I'm going to spend a few words on a relationship between inequality and justice, in the sense that we might ask whether there is anything unjust in the fact that the distribution of resources is unequal. And clearly, if we look at the natural distributions, many thinkers have already pointed out that there is nothing unjust about that. But what if the trade contributes to an increase in the inequality in the distribution of resources? We can in this case the problem is that it wouldn't even exist if that resource was so abundant that nobody would use all of it. But the problem becomes more crucial when this resource is scarce. And so to drive our thoughts, we can first of all remember that they look at the right to water for food from using this the notion of positive and negative rights. A negative right is a right that doesn't oblige any action. So the right of speech is a typical example. Nobody else needs to do anything to allow me to exercise my right to speech other than having to listen to me. But a positive right instead requires an action that can be from a state, from a government, from a community. And so it's the right to food is one of those rights. So if someone doesn't have enough food, there is an entity, can be a state, that is responsible to make sure that this right is not violated. So food has been recognized as a human right. And since the production of food requires water and land, implicitly it has been recognized also a right to water for food production and to land to produce food. We can think of some principles of land and water justice that are based on or are somehow connected to this right to food. If we call W as the water for food production, we can think of having two different thresholds. A minimum threshold, below the threshold we have a condition of undernourishment because there isn't enough water to produce enough food to feed a certain community. Above the in the second threshold is a threshold that is a threshold of abundance. If we have water that is above an amount of water that is about W star, there is no water limitation. Nobody would use that water, the fraction of water above this threshold. And then in the middle, we might have another situation that, of course, we don't need to live at the edges of the minimum amount. We want to have some comfort. We can call this interval as an interval of well-being. On the basis of the definitions I have given, we have that making sure that the population has at least enough water to reach that W minimum is a way to make sure that a positive right is not violated. And so this right should be protected even if the scarcity is not induced by human activities. Instead, in this well-being range, we being having access to this water, and I don't say that it's a luxury, it's still a right, but it's a negative right. So it's a right that everybody has to make sure that nobody takes it away from a certain population, should be protected, but only if some human activities deprive that population from access to that amount of food. So with this, probably I should have said at the beginning, we found a certain gap in the literature trying to give us a sense of how the distribution of natural resources can, and an unequal distribution of natural resources may constitute a form of injustice, so some human rights are violated or not. And so with this framework, we propose a way to look at this issue. And so if, just to summarize, if inequality in water use is unjust or unfortunate, so if we are below, if a man-made inequality reduces the population's access to a certain amount of water, that is the second threshold, that the W star, we find it around 1,300 cubic meters per capita per year. So this could be a problem. Or if the inequality induced by nature, in this case we would select a different threshold in around that 1,000, just to summarize, because so unjust if man-induced activities reduce the availability of water below this higher threshold, and unjust also if there is no intervention to make sure that everybody have access to this minimum value. So now, just to show the data, if we look at the global distribution of water, we did it in this analysis in two ways, water and the effect of trade. We find that the line with trade most of the times is below the other line, so which means that the trade overall improves the situation. There isn't only for some years at the beginning of this observation period, there is a situation in which trade reduces the number of people in the world that have access to that well-being interval of water availability. In the second case, in the case of malnourishment, we see that, again, at the beginning there are some problems. Overall, there is an improvement, but still, using these thresholds that were been determined by other authors, we find that overall there is an improvement, but still there is a substantial fraction of the human population that is below that malnourishment threshold, which is clearly different from the thresholds used by the UN to define malnourishment, because we have a substantial fraction of the human population. So overall trade improves the situation, and this is the main take-home message of this part of the study. Then the other part I was trying to stress is that trade is not a long-term solution. So we can have a situation in which we said that the local supply is higher than the demand, and a situation of deficit. We have been looking at, and this is work done with Samir Swayze, who is in the room, and Andrea and Amos. So we were trying to look at the population dynamics using a classic logistic growth, where K is the carrying capacity, and in countries that and the carrying capacity can be depend on local resources, or can depend on resources that become also accounting for the fact that part of the resources become available through trade. So if we do this analysis, and this is a different way to show what I just said, we can have a local carrying capacity that depends only on local resources, or a virtual carrying capacity that depends also on trade. If we fit the data, and in this curve, basically, we have a K, or a carrying capacity that is imposed and is coming from calculations of water availability. And we have an alpha coefficient of the logistic growth that is determined through fitting. We find overall that we can define split countries in two main groups. countries that are trade dependent, that are the red countries, are countries that clearly we cannot find any good fitting to the logistic growth by using the local accounting only for local resources. We need to to account also for trade. Instead, in the countries that are the net exporters, in those countries we see that the best fit is obtained if we rely only on the local resources. So this means that water-rich countries, in their, these countries, the pattern of population growth relies on water resources that are currently committed to importing countries. And instead, the importing countries clearly rely on their imports in their long-term path of population growth. So there is a double accounting problem, that the demographic growth of the exporters does not account for the fact that it's currently exporting part of their water resources. So in this unbalanced situation, we expect that in the long run, the exporters will have to reduce the exportation. This is what happened in the recent food crisis of 2008-2011. When, because of the skyrocketing of food prices, importing countries, exporting countries, to contain the increase in food prices, banned exports and created a situation of panic in importing countries. So overall, there is again this unbalanced situation that is associated with the global trade of water. So how are countries preparing for a food or water crisis? If you look at this recent food crisis, they started with droughts in some parts of the world, and then there were new policies on biofuels. China became a major importer of food. There has been an increase in demand and a decline in supply. Prices went up again, these export bans, and the situation of food insecurity, which means that some countries realized that they needed to ensure a more direct access to land for food production, instead of having to rely on these very uncertain markets. In the same case, some investors saw some prospects for profitable investments in agriculture because of the high food prices, and also because some of the crops could have been sold at prices that are tied not to the food market but to the fuel markets. And so before I said that this scorers in this process that I'm going to talk about of large scale land acquisitions as a process that could be a new revolution that could increase food production and everybody would be happy. So this is why I quote here Thomas Jefferson, who apparently said that every generation needs a new revolution. And so and I do this because I gave this talk at my university and it's almost a requirement there to cite Jefferson. So, but they... there are the two different sides of the story. There is a development opportunity, but there is also the impression that there could be another form of colonialism or exploitation of the poor in the world. And so the word that is usually used for this type of phenomenon is land and water grabbing. We learn that it's considered politically not correct because by using this word is a negative aspect, and so implicitly would accept one of the two sides of the story. So I will not use this word, but usually land grabbing is defined when these transactions have no transparency, there is no consistent previous agreement, etc. No respect also to the environment. And it's very hard to define, if we look at the data on these large-scale land acquisitions, it's very hard to identify situations that constitute a real land grab because the information on the transparency of the land deals is not available. The two different parts of the story, again, it's a win-win opportunity for opportunity for development. This was the position of Chakrabarty. He was the head of the European Bank for Development, and Da Silva is, I think, still the Secretary General of the FAO. On the other side, we the idea that there is a risk of exploitation and violation of human rights. One of the figures who brought up this point was De Schutter, who used to be the rapporteur for the right to food. So we reconstructed the network of large-scale land acquisitions, and we tried then to quantify, to have a really to say something about this phenomenon. We have an idea of need to have an idea of the resources, and I will look mostly at the water that are appropriated with the land. So this, in terms of amount of land, it's a relatively large amount of land. It's more than twice the agricultural land in Germany. It's bigger than Italy. And most of the land is acquired in Africa and in Asia. If we the impacts on the livelihoods can be studied by looking at appropriation, for example, of freshwater resources. And we see again that the most targeted continents are Africa and Southeast Asia. And we calculated the water acquired by looking at water acquired in areas that have been contracted, in areas that are contracted but are not under production, and then only intended deals. Intended deals means very little because we don't know if they will ever be concluded. You can also look at different amounts of water, rainwater or irrigation water, and we can determine all these different amounts. They don't tell us much unless we put these numbers in a context. To do this, we look at other forms of grabbing. So groundwater depletion is clearly a grabbing from the next generation, and we see that the water grabbing we are talking about now is already bigger than that number. It's very close to the global groundwater withdrawals. It's more than the water used for biofuels, and it's a substantial fraction of the global virtual water trade. And the trajectory is a trajectory of increasing land acquisitions. So even more important would be to look at the food that can be produced in this land. And relying on this data from the Land Metrics, which is an organization that compiled a data set of large-scale land acquisitions, we see that they report also information on crops. And these crops are pretty... then we can use national yields and determine the amount of food that can be produced. And then we can look also at calculations done by other authors for each country on how much more food can be produced if we were able to close the yield gap. Because this is the development opportunity that many scholars in this field have been talking about. So potentially, this is in terms of calories. Again, they don't tell us much, but let's convert calories in number of people, looking at either a balanced diet or a diet that is the typical diet of each country. We see that overall, we talk about 300 millions, and most of these countries are countries where there is some malnourishment, and this food would be sufficient to abate malnourishment in these countries. With this, we are not claiming that this food is taken directly or is causing the malnourishment in these countries, just again to put these numbers in a perspective. So it's the take-home message we obtain is that there could be a significant impact on livelihoods, or at least there are some resources that are taken away from countries that would have a use for those resources. Again, the literature is pretty much split between people who maintain that this is idle land, is underutilized land, is land that is not doing any good to the local communities, and other part of the literature that reports about evictions, people forced out of their land, or the fact that the people subsistence farming is dying because of this acquisition. So impacts on the environment are also hard to evaluate because most of the times we don't have the exact location of these land deals. So this is again work done by Christina, her students, and our group. So we have been looking at the different we have been able to locate each land deal because we found a record of the investor and another registry of the location of the these acquired lands. We see that all the these lands, in this case of Indonesia, are located in areas affected by deforestation. Deforestation data here are at 30 meters resolution, so it's high resolution data. So with a certain precision, we can really say what is written there, that 70% of the land acquired has been deforested in the same time frame. And this land is being used for oil plantations, which are used, we have seen before, for biofuels. This is a bigger picture. Now we are in the process of identifying also in the other parts of Indonesia, and then we will move to other parts of the world. So there are clearly some environmental impacts. Deforestation is one of them. Tropical deforestation is often associated with land degradation. And so these are, we can show that there is an impact. While until now, most of the times, there is just a description and no actual data. The other big environmental impact is, again, this loss of environmental stewardship. We have a land that is managed by owners or corporations that own this land are placed in the other part of the world. So now there are other aspects of the story. So I said this phenomenon of large-scale land acquisitions are discussed from the point of view of livelihoods, from the point of view of human rights, from the point of view of environmental degradation. Another aspect is the land tenure. And just very briefly, we heard many talks here today about the common property regimes. The common property regimes have one of their strengths is the fact that nobody owned the land, which means that in the past, no owner, no farmer was able in moments of hardship to sell the land. And so the land was passed to the next generation. Unfortunately now, because one of the problems is that governments take ownership of the land, or at least make decisions about that land, and the users have no voice because they don't have any title on the land. So is water grabbing right? Clearly, if there is no involvement of users, if there is violation of human rights, etc., this is not even a question. But here we argue, in this paper, we argue that there are some problems in general with these large-scale land acquisitions. So even if they were the result of an informed and free decision of previous land users, because they imply a commodification of the land. And again, I'm glad Marino talked about weak sustainability before, because this could be an example of weak sustainability in which a community decides to substitute a natural capital for a manufactured or human-made capital. And usually, in this paper, we reported the example of Nauru Island, because it's always used in the context of weak sustainability, when the population of this island decided to sell the soil because it was rich in phosphate. Now the land is degraded. The proceeds from the sale of the phosphates in Nauru Island was used to establish a trust fund. The population was supposed to leave out of the trust fund. Clearly, then the trust fund, because of mismanagement or because of the volatility of the markets, collapsed, and they were heavily hit by the crisis of 2007-2008. We cannot replace a natural capital that would have been, like the land, that would have been there for the generation to come, with financial capital. And so here I'm citing again Partha Dasgupta, because in this paper that Andrea sent to me a few weeks ago, he used this sentence that no economy can survive without a natural capital. And this would be an example that if a country sells a substantial fraction of its agricultural land, there are some implications on the long-term sustainability of that country. So just to summarize, I've been looking at mechanisms of trade and redistribution of resources through trade or through these large-scale land acquisitions, trying to highlight some weaknesses of these redistributions. We saw that the good news is that they improve equality, or at least they, there is a better, thanks to this redistribution, more people can enjoy their rights to food. But at the same time, there are some implications associated with loss of environmental stewardship, to with a loss of livelihoods, like in the case of land grabbing. So with this, I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Paolo. Beautiful talk. Many issues, extremely important, and.